2 or 3 days, absolutely.
Don't know at the time, but it was a conscious decision. I applied for quite a lot of jobs when I came out of university. I was a master in economics, as you just said. But I wanted to go into a more technical role. So I actually did a lot of self-study in my year that I actually did another master after my master, which was cultural studies. And I started programming. I became a Java developer, or at least I got a certificate, but I didn't know who Java developer was. I had a certificate and I knew it from the book, but I never really programmed anything. And I applied and through the in different companies, and I ended up at a consultancy. But I also applied at banks. I applied in an IT integration company, so it wasn't a conscious choice at that moment. But I ended up in a consultancy, capital markets consultancy, so financial services, as a Java developer. And I made a lot of mistakes in those first months because I learned what real programming was when I was there. And from there, I was in a consultant context. And basically, I stayed in that consultant context until today.
What's the thing that you like most, consultants?
There's lots of things I like about consultancy. I think it's one of the main things, though, is the fact that you can swim through a lot of different waters. You can see a lot of different environments. You enter a lot of different. You can enter a lot of different companies, meet a lot of different people, cultures, even going to different countries. I worked 15 years abroad. I worked in France, in Paris, in London, in Zurich, Belgium, the Netherlands, and it's the variation and the fact that you're never really doing exactly the same thing. It's always something different and always something new to do, and that's what really attracted me.
Okay, and the tree is the way I pronounce correct?
That's exactly the thing that I didn't like anymore after some years or so. I've not made a choice to be a consultant. Some moment in time, I was working for a company, a government company, the world was not challenging anymore. So what did I do? I did look for another opportunity, and it was quite accident, consultancy. Consultancy at Carrefour, in that time it was called the GB and Yogadan. And finally, the company I was working for went bankrupt. So I became even a freelancer. Consultant for a long time between, let's say, 1988, a lot of you weren't even born. I started my career, it's just between brackets, I started my career with punched cards. I don't know if any one of you know punched cards, but I started my career like that. We had a mainframe and we had a disk of 400 megabytes. So, yeah, okay, but I was working for Carrefour. My company went bankrupt, so I became a freelancer. I've been freelancer until 2005. I've been working for a lot of companies also, mainly in the financial world, but also for the energy and for the automotive world. And at a certain moment in time, 2000, there was the year 2K, 2002, there was the euro, and then after that, the market went really down for a lot of consultants, and I chose to be an employee again. And I liked it very much.
And what's the thing that you like as being the...
I especially like to be part of something, to be part of, and I'm going to make some publicity, of the love brand. So it's strange. When I was younger, I'm 62 today. When I was younger, I really liked change constantly. I still do like change, but within the same environment. So what I really like today is I've made that choice. Financially, I made a little step backwards. But I'm very happy I did make that choice because now I feel like I'm really part of something and I'm really making things better and making some profit for our company Belfius. And if you have seen the latest results of Belfius, they were splendid.
Jelle, do you recognize yourself in the story?
I do recognize it. It seems a bit of a trend in this panel that we didn't really choose for consulting. It kind of happened to me too, so I must confess that it's practically the same. Started out as a network engineer and then moved on to programming at some point, back to my roots at that moment. And I started with projects, internal projects, and then at some point there was a question from one of our customers. I came to stay at the moment for a consulting position. So I moved to KBC, stayed there for 5 years as a consultant. It's a bit of a gray line if you're still a consultant at that moment or that you're an employee for KBC, just been paid by another firm. But I think I learned a lot there, and that's where my consulting career started. It's very interesting as a consultant that you have a lot of diversity, and you can easily switch between customers or firms or assignments. You see a lot of the business world as a consultant. If you start from the beginning as an internal employee, it's kind of easy to stay at that company, but you don't see the rest of the world and you have nothing to compare it with. So to the young people that are still in the decision-making process, I would say if you're young, an internal job is interesting to have a position and get some experience, but don't stay too long and try out a few different things before you make up your mind where you want to stay. And consultancy is a very good way of doing that. And at any point in your career, you can always choose to say, okay, I've seen enough, I know what I want, and now I can go for a long time in a good position.
Okay. And Wido, you have never been in consultant? Was that a deliberate decision?
It was definitely a deliberate decision. Like you said, I really want to be part of something, and putting that other company between that and the company I'm working for feels like a bridge that shouldn't be there. And especially when you want to build to something, you want to go together, and you want to build together for it.
Okay. So, still not working. Ah, there it is. So I found a study last week which said that almost 8 out of 10 consultants work more hours a week than stated in their contract. And that's even just a couple of hours, but it's on average 9.5 hours. Do you recognize this?
Yes.
Why do you think you'll be consultants to that?
That's really, I think they want to impress their line managers.
Because a lot of employees, and especially now, I think a lot of employees that are really bothering about their work, they are really doing massive hours of work, more than before maybe, and because before you had to come to, in my case, to Brussels, you need a Brussels at 5 or 6, and then work is done. But now, in the time of telework and homework, I think we all do a lot of hours, and it is not specifically for consulting. Not today. It may have been before, but not today.
Yeah, so Wido, do you recognize yourself in this, or is it?
I can agree that at our company, also people, we have freelancers, we have consultants, we have internal employees, and it really depends on the person that wants to put in the extra hours and feels comfortable.
And what do you think is impacting your work-life balance if you work so much time?
It's very difficult. So certainly now with the teleworking, with a big family at home, and it's very difficult sometimes to get some time to work. don't think that anybody can do this. So we are a morning person, a night person, whatever. But apart from doing more hours than you you should do, or you set in your contract, I think that's a mindset. And it also depends on the function that you perform. For example, now these days I'm a business analyst, and you cannot turn off your mind. All the problems you've got during the day, they keep spinning, and when you go to sleep, you're still working out stuff. It sometimes happens that I wake up and I have to take notes for the next day because we'll be gone by morning. My case. But it's a mountain, and I don't mind. I like doing my work, and I don't think it's a consulting thing. I think it's just if you like doing your job, you just won't turn it off. It's easier when you're at a company and you drive home and you have a clear barrier that you go through, and then you say, okay, now I'm home. That's it for today. With teleworking, that is gone, of course, and that makes it a lot more difficult.
Okay, and I think you work both as an employee and a consultant. Do you see any differences in work-life balance between these two roles?
I think the kind of consultancy that I did was also the kind of consultancy that I was doing. I was a developer, I was an analyst, I was a product lead as a consultant. I think it's mainly indeed the mindset that's working here when you're in. And I always say that today also, and people that are working for me here, they know that if you feel like you need to do something because otherwise you have more stress than when you are not doing it, do it, please. But if you feel that you have to do it because your boss asked for it, try to avoid it. It's just a question of mindset. I know that it is difficult as a young person to say no to your boss, to your, either it is a functional boss or the IR of the boss. But try to switch off at 6 in the evening, 7 in the evening, and then it is done. I know Jelle is a different person, and some persons are different. But, as a project lead and as a consultant, I didn't have any problem with switching off after 8, 9, 10 hours of work. As an independent entrepreneur, then I had some difficulties, of course. That's not, I was starting up a company, so then I was working day and night also. But as a consultant, I had a feeling that I did not have to do more than my colleagues and employees.
Maybe I can add one thing about the consultancy. It's a mainly value-driven work that we do, result-based, that has ups and downs. You work in projects, you work mainly on the change side, not on the run side of the organization. And in the project context, you have peaks, you have issues. And in those peaks, yes, you do extra hours because they are needed. But I agree with everything that has been said here, and there's a link with passion and purpose there. If you're ambitious, if you want to go for something, don't look at those hours in the contract. They don't matter. They don't mean anything. It's about what you want to do and what you want to invest in. And if you invest in something, if you want to be somewhere that you want to be, then you have to invest that energy. You don't care about the hours.
Okay, I think
today, indeed. More and more companies, larger companies, corporate companies, are really managing on result and no longer on time. They are not managing on someone who is working from 9 to 5. They are managing from what are the people doing. If they are doing it at night, as Jelle, or if they are doing it early in the morning or late in the evening, it doesn't matter. Result is the main driver.
So I think daily work might be the most important decision for young people like here in this room to decide whether they want to be a consultant or whether they want to be an internal employee. Are there any advantages of being a consultant or being an employee that the other don't have?
That's a very difficult personally have a very big problem with that, because you're doing the same work, you're helping internalists. The reason why there's an external person on the project is because they didn't find anybody to do it internally, or it's a short period project, and hiring somebody full time for it would be too costly. So you're helping out the company in the same way that the internal person is helping. So I think that's a mindset that is still in, certainly in bigger companies, is still a problem. But other than that, what are the benefits? If you're a consultant, whenever you say you have a problem with a co-worker or a boss that you work for, or a project that is not very interesting or not challenging enough, you can easily go back to your own firm and say, sorry, but this is not going to work. Can you please find me another project? You move to another project, that's an easy step to make. And perhaps in the next month, you can already deal on another project. If you're an internal employee and you don't like the project, or you don't like the boss you're working for, it cannot be that easy. Sometimes it can be very difficult to get out of that situation, or you have to leave the company completely. That's also a decision that is not very easy for anybody to make. So I think the biggest benefit as a consultant is that you can easily switch over to another project whenever it's needed. But you can still stay. I did my first consultancy job for 5 years in the same company, in the same team. So for me, there was really no different than being an internal employee at that point. When I left there after 5 years, I got the same farewell as anybody who worked there internally, because they worked with me for 5 years. So it was, it's the same thing at that point. It's an easier choice in the beginning when you want to know and start knowing the world and knowing which sector you want to work, or big companies or startup companies or whatever. As a consultant, you can easily try out different scenes.
I think as an internal employee, you can have the same benefits, but you have to be strong-willed enough maybe to say, I'm leaving here and I'm in a company. But if you expect to be treated the same as an internal, as a consultant, but you want the freedom to leave on the spot in the next month, if you say so, that's very hard for a company to digest as well. You're planned into planning, into a project. You have to talk about that, get the same process as being an internal employee. But there's an extra company in between benefiting of your relationship. And that's something that I sometimes just cannot comprehend. Like, I can understand the situation that you're saying about we need something on this short notice. That's very difficult to find an internal employee, I understand that. But when there's a shortage on the market, you're taking advantage of that and even making more money of it, because you're hoarding the resources, actually, as all the consultants you're offering. Yeah, I wanna build that connection with the company, and I feel that if you put that other company in between and you want the flexibility to move from one project to another, then you're putting an estimate in the relationship kind of. You're saying like, I'm independent and if I want to, I'm just leaving. You can do the same as an internal, but it's a different mindset.
It's a very interesting discussion, and what I already talked about it at the table over there. I think the most important thing for all of you is don't lie to yourself. Don't lie to yourself. If you are, and I have been lying to myself for a while, because internally I'm a real group person. I'm a person that is really not, in fact, that was not talking too much, maybe today I'm talking too much, but really a blue person. But if you feel like you are a person that likes to analyze, if you feel that you are a person that likes to be in a corner and develop things and be busy with technology, please don't lie to yourself and don't want to be a CEO of Belfius, for example. But if you like change, if you are really for change, if you know what you want to be doing, if you know which direction you want to go in the next task, for example, please choose for the consultancy business and try to work on the projects that are really in the expertise that you want to go with. Now, I can say I've done a lot of things, and I have had some flat deals also, because after the Euro 2002, there was really a really blast in the market. People were not hiring, so then that was difficult. But as a consultant, you can still find projects that you really like, always. But I chose after a while to be an employee, and I'm very happy for that. And I understand, so the discussion, that's why I say, please don't lie to yourself. Do what you want to do.
But you can find that flexibility as well as in freelance.
Of course.
Just going on your own and going out there. If it's more difficult, of course. But
I can only talk for my own company, for the experience that I had. And you are very right. In some companies, you can easily change projects. You can easily change teams. You can easily change processes. But there are some companies where it's not possible. Some companies, consultants are treated the same way than the employees. In other companies, I've been there also in an automotive company. I mean, the idea of knowledge, that we were treated as third, as a consultant. And that's very few. So from time to time, you have to make that choice. I like to go to an automotive company because I was working always in the financial market. It was completely different, but they treated me as a consultant as third. So you have to take that also into account. It can happen.
So I think a really nice conversation is going on. We have to move a little bit before the editorial. So I found this just a quote which says, a lot of students says that responsibility is one of the key motivators for employees. And then this quote says basically that as an employer, you shouldn't give your employees or consultants a lot of responsibility, but instead you should create an environment where they can take it themselves. So it's someone who can want to react on it.
Like you touched earlier, in our company we work with the Teal principle, and that's based on a really flat culture. We don't have any team leads or project leads, and we all work on a basis that everyone is kind of equal. But you still need people that take the responsibility in a project and bring it from start to finish, and those people come literally, and they grow, and you have to nurture it. But if you give the opportunity and the space to do that, people will take it upon them, and they will love it and even get more ownership and responsibility for it.
Even in a flat structure, our role and responsibilities are very important, and I fully agree. If you give them the space and people to take up the space they need, they will take responsibility, and that's a big move. It links also again to that purpose question, because it's all linked, and it's finding yourself. What kind of impact do you want to have on the organization? What kind of value do you want to represent for your organization? What can you also, if you link yourself to the organization, in that context. then work becomes life. And then it's no longer work-life balance, it's work-life integration.
So, Patrick, as being both a consultant as an employee, do you think that one of the roles, that responsibility is more important than the other?
Well, just like I said, I think responsibility is a measurable term. If you're really in a flat structure, you are in a high-level structure, like in the financial world, it's still the case, then that's different. You're giving the responsibility and you have to take it. But I think that if you like it, you will take it and you will take some ownership. But ownership is something that you take at every level. Even if it is a flat structure, natural talent will become, it will come forward. Someone who is developing, he will take the ownership of that part of what he is developing. Someone who is mainly responsible for the complete project, he will do what he needs to do for having the result. So I think indeed that responsibility and ownership can be done on every level, being a consultant or it doesn't matter. And you see that people are really taking ownership. You are a person that likes to be in the corner and doing the stuff is responsible and you feel responsible for that part of the project. If you're a project lead, you are responsible for communication and you communicate and you take that part. And I think even, I'm pretty sure I never had the opportunity, but I'm pretty sure that even in a flat organization, it can even work better than even high value organization.
I think the problem lies perhaps in the word giving responsibility. If you give responsibility to somebody and it's not really his own decision to have that responsibility, that doesn't work. Unless, of course, you know the person and you know that he has it inside, or she has it inside. But if you know them and you know they have that and they will take it up, that's a different thing, of course. Most of the time, you just give them the opportunity, and if they have it, they will take it as responsibility. And that works. But giving it just like that doesn't
work. Okay, and speaking about knowledge and skills, and you can start from right to left. What do you think are the most important knowledge and skills that you need for your work?
That's a very broad question, of course. I think knowledge and skills are very interesting, but I think experience is even more important. It doesn't necessarily have to go together with knowledge and skills forever. You do what you like to do, but having the experience of doing it for 10 years, for example, gives you knowledge that you cannot learn, that you have to. Yeah, you learn over time, of course, but it's a very difficult thing. Purely knowledge and skills, it's difficult to answer.
A career, in my view, a career, the first 5 years you learn about skills. It's when you learn the content of the job you're in. And you might change jobs a few times and you will have a career. For example, that in HR now, I don't know that much about HR, but I'm learning. In HR, it's fun.
And you want to do HR.
It's also but in the first 5 years, you learn those hard skills. Yeah, no worries, and then it's all about the soft skills. If you want to grow, if you want to have an impact, if you want to influence, if you want to create your own impact on that organization, and again, it comes from the authenticity, the thing you want to represent in that organization, in that context, it's all about the soft skills. Because the hard skills you have, and there is an end to that learning. Of course, there's always evolution, IT evolves, everything is evolving, and you keep up to date with those principles. But that's just learning. The rest is connecting with people and making things happen together with people. And that's where the real impact is.
Yeah, I can agree. It's about the attitude of a person and someone and his willingness to put forward his best, like if you can say. And
So a common assumption about consultancy is that there's a lot of flexibility, you should treat clients, you can have to work for a single client for a long period. I'm really curious to one of the people who worked as an employee, do you think that being an employee has the same flexibility? And if not, how do you ensure that you get some more flexibility?
I think it depends on your personality. If you are communicating with your boss, with your environment, if you are telling what you can, if you are showing what you can, if you show some visibility, if you talk to your boss, if you talk to your colleagues, you will have the flexibility. In companies that I know, you will have the flexibility of changing regularly, not every month, but also the person changes every month. So he finalizes a project. And I think as an employee, you can do that. The only thing is you have to come forward. You have to be that person that says, I am here, I am available for others, other challenges. And if you choose me, I will do my very best and I will make it happen. And that's something, yeah, consultants have that more in them than employees, I think. It's just based on personality. But if you can do that, I'm pretty sure that in every company you can have that kind of flexibility that a consultant can also have during his service
career. Someone else want to elaborate on that?
I fully agree with that, and I think flexibility is something we all need these days. And companies are offering, whether they need consultancy or internal, and I think COVID-19 also showed us that. That context and that a lot is possible. The hybrid way of working, and again, result based, value based, it's not about the hours you spend, it's about the value that you bring together with the results. And when you do that, during the day, you need that flexibility. Again, everybody's different, so everybody probably has a different hour when they are productive, when they want to do things. So different contexts and organizations do need to take that into account.
And they do. Most of the companies today, they do that, they know, they've seen it, that it can work, so yeah.
Yeah, because when you say flexibility, you talk about, you have to put yourself out there and talk about it, and maybe then even being employee, internal, is maybe more flexible because you have only one party to communicate to, so there's less communicating and less points of failure, because communicating is the hardest thing as humans to bring over your own idea onto someone else. That's like the hardest thing you can do. And if there is a party less in between there, then that's less difficult, I would say. So maybe more flexible.
Okay. So I think there's a nice conversation going on, and I can imagine that there are a lot of questions from the audience. So who has a nice question? And the best thing is that I don't have names, so I cannot point to someone who's our questions.
I do have a question. So when looking at recent events on the job market, we see that in some countries, Scandinavian countries, are already stepping off from the 40-hour week. In Belgium, we also had kind of a change. We stepped off from the 5-day week, still work 38 hours, 40 hours. And I do believe that this might be a change that's going to work for employees. But when looking at consultancy, this becomes a very difficult change. So how do you look at this?
Well, I don't think it will be such a difficult change. It's a contractual thing to compensate if you work 4 days a week. The problem is that now here in Belgium, they decided that those should be 4 days of 10 hours. So it's really not a change, just cramming all the hours in 4 days instead of 5 days, which we are already doing since we're working at home. You can do everything you want in 4 days and then you have 1 day off if you want to. So there is not really a change. The real change is that we should go to a 4-day week with just 8 hours. And you will do the same in those 4 days than you do on 5 days of 8 hours. And that's the real change. this, they do even 6 to 7 hours a day for 4 days, and they get more done than on a full 5 day week of 8 hours a day. So, but if you go to the consultancy part there, if you go to a week being 4 days, instead of well, billing by the hour, as most contracts do, I think those will be just recalculated as being that you come to the same sum at the end of the week. So I don't think that there will really be a big impact for consulting.
I also agree that if you bill by the day, that is probably what's going to happen. But consultancy work is moving contractually also a lot to fixed price work and value based. You have to bring a result, and however you do that, whatever skills you need, you organize that internally. How many people you need, there's a price for the work and the impact that you do, and then the hours again don't matter, but there's a price related to it, and whether you do that in 4 or 3 or in 5 days, no difference. But that's indeed where the consultancy needs to go towards.
Even employees. We like I said before, we are really managing more on output, on result than on time. So if you bring result, we will be managing the result, and we will take care for the fact that you have more than enough work for 4 days, even for 5 days. But if I see the result of that, well, like Jelle says, you can do a lot on 4 days, you can do a lot in 3 days. You have to focus, and you can do that also, and employees can do that. So managing on result is mainly the change, not managing on 4 days or 5 days.
Someone else has a question. So if there are not questions, you know, I'm really curious, do you have one final last advice or final word that you want to share with?
Perhaps I can just address a misunderstanding that you have. First of all, when you talk about the extra energy in between, that makes it more difficult to communicate to the customer when you're a consultant. That's rarely the case. In my experience, it makes it even easier. So when you have a problem with the company you work for, so the customer, not the company actually pays you as a consultant, the customer, you have a problem there, you can go directly to the customer. Your own company will rarely mix in that communication unless you ask for it. But that's the extra advantage you have. If you cannot communicate with the customer, you can go to your own boss and say, I have a problem with getting this over to the customer. Perhaps you can take that up and you can talk to them. And if that doesn't work, then you had 2 tries on the same communication. And if that also fails, then I think that's a moment that you have to decide perhaps another project will be more suitable for me. The other misconception that you go to as a consultant, you go to a customer for the short term projects, is not really the case. I can prove that with my 5 years at KBC. I only take up projects where I know that it will be at least a year and more years, hopefully. You cannot count on that, but you can see intention of the customer. If they want somebody for a few months, then I immediately say, sorry, I don't do that. But there are consultants who you can choose that, of course. If you say, I want to see every aspect of the market, I want to go to 10 companies in the next 5 years, and you only take up projects of a maximum of 6 months, that's your choice, of course. If a customer, and you say, well, why is there an extra firm in between taking up the money? No, there is just a question for a project for 6 months, and you want somebody for 6 months, you don't hire somebody internally for 6 months. So advantage is that as a customer, if you want to hire somebody internally, going with the consultant first is a good way to try them out. You can prove yourself as a consultant. If the customer is really happy with you, he will offer you the opportunity to come internal. So there are a lot of extras that are forgotten when the consultant is in the mix. And that's why it's a misconception that I hear a lot and I heard a lot over the years, but I just wanted to address.
And that is where management of Exellys comes in. Eh? They have to defend their consultants.
So, he has had a lot of time to think about questions. Someone has a question?